We're taking the last seven statements that Jesus said from the cross. And it was a day that man, he endured the worst day of his life, the most painful day of his life. And he's teaching us some principles and truths from the cross on how we can endure our most painful day. And I believe every person needs a framework in how they're going to process their bad days, their difficult seasons. Everybody needs a framework in how they're going to process those experiences and those seasons in life. And what Jesus is teaching us here, that we're showing every word is meaningful and intentional. It has purpose, and there is purpose behind every statement. And we're learning how to handle the most difficult days of our life, because Jesus endured the worst day of his, and he's teaching us how to endure the worst days that are yet to come in our life. So Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 is our theme verse. Let me read it for you one more time. It says, keep your eyes on Jesus. That's what we're doing. Who both began and finished the race we're in. Study how he did it, because he endured. It says he never lost sight of the finish line, he said, that exhilarating finish in and with God. The finish line for him was heaven. The Bible says that he was able to endure the cross, the shame, whatever, because he never lost sight of where he was headed. And it says now he's there in the place of honor, right alongside of God. And this statement that we're in today, the fifth statement, is found in John chapter 19. Jesus is unfolding the secret in overcoming hardships here, and together we're going to study how he did it. John 19, verse 28, it says, later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, here's the fifth statement, he said, hanging there, I am thirsty. I'm thirsty. And the jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. His plea, Jesus' plea for a drink, is a reminder to us that no one is in complete control of their life. You are not so spiritual, so strong, so self-sufficient, so all together that you don't need somebody else's help. There is no one. Jesus is here on the cross, the Lord of all creation, the man God in the flesh, who needs some help from other people. He's thirsty. And he needs help. Here's the fifth principle. If you want to endure your most painful days, your painful seasons, here's the principle Jesus is teaching us from the cross. Write it down this way. Be human enough to acknowledge your need. Be human. Okay, you want to endure, if you want to overcome and triumph over those difficult seasons, you need to be human enough. Today I want to talk to you about being real. Just being authentic. Being transparent, not pretending, not playing the phony game, not acting like we got it all figured out all the time, because the reality is we don't. And if the Son of God requested help during his bad day, it would be wise for us to take note of that and realize, you know what, I probably need some help in the middle of my bad days, and stop acting like I got it figured out, or like it's not happening, or whatever it is. We don't want to ask for help. So today I want to talk to you about being real, and being authentic, and being transparent. But before I do, I want to kind of just make an observation with you, and delineate what I'm saying and what I'm not saying, because there's two ways of being real. You can either be raw, or you can be redeemed. Those are two ways. And some of you are authentic. It's you. I hate people. I just hate people, Pastor. I heard that. I just hate people. You know, I hate. All right. You know what? That's cool. You're being authentic. You're just raw. So what's the difference? The difference here of being raw is, this is raw chicken right here. You're uncooked. You're unfiltered, unbridled. So your emotions and your words, they're not passing through your faith. They're not passing through the Word of God. It's not passing through some secrets. I'm going to tell you today, in order to move from raw to redeemed, it needs to pass through some things. And see, you can be authentically raw, and all you're doing is passing around your salmonella, contaminating people. Good for you. Oh, you're being real. You're being authentic. But it's you're also, in the process, you're just contaminating other people with your raw self. Okay? So what I want to share with you today is don't just be raw. And you know what? Don't just be real. Don't just be the real you. Be the redeemed you. See, the redeemed you is real. It's still real. It's the same emotions. It's the same feelings. It's the same thoughts. It's the same life experiences. But the difference is wisdom. The difference is it's taken those raw emotions, those raw words, those raw thoughts, and it has filtered them through the Word of God. Has filtered through faith. It is filtered through some things I'm going to share with you today and what the product of that is. I'm not contaminating anybody. We can eat some chicken. You know what I mean? We can have a good time. Okay? You know, I just want to give you a picture today because the world celebrates raw. Culture celebrates raw today. You got Kardashians. You got Kanye. You got all these people. We watch these shows of just people being raw. And we celebrate people for their rawness, that they have this ugly, bad, sinful attitude and behaviors. And we say, yeah, they're keeping it real. Understandably so, but why should we celebrate that ugliness? Why should you celebrate sin? Don't settle for that. Don't be raw, be real, be redeemed, okay? So I want to teach you how to do that, how to be real, and how to be redeemed. It's actually, I want to show you some roadblocks to being real. Because there are some very real roadblocks for us being authentic and transparent and living a life that is that way. And I don't know what it is about just it's human nature to want to conceal ourselves, isn't it? It's human nature to want to hide away and to hide. It's the very first sin in the garden, right? And Adam and Eve had sinned, and what did they go do? They went hid. They said they were, because they were the number one reason why we hide and why we don't live transparently, fear. Fear. They said, oh, we were afraid. We were afraid because we disobeyed. We were afraid because we knew you were coming. You're going to be mad at us. We were afraid. There's this pastor who did house-to-house visitations, and he would visit some new people that would visit his, you know, come to the church and fill out the cards, and we don't do that here, we don't go knocking on doors, but this guy would, he'd get a card, go knock on the door, and go say hello to people, and there was this one guy who'd been coming to his church for a while, and he filled out a card after a month or so, and pastor went over to his house and knocked on the door, and no one's coming, and so pastor just knocks again. He stands there for a couple minutes and knocking. And he says, okay, you know, his car's here, you know. And he says, all right, maybe he just doesn't want to talk to me. So he goes into his car and he goes, you know what, I'm just going to, he just thought it'd be funny. So he sent him a little text. Revelations 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And then he gets his stuff ready, you know, and he's about to drive away, and he gets a text back from the guy, and it says, Genesis 3:10, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked. So, again, nothing to do with the message, just funny. So let me give you these three fundamental fears that are keeping you from having good relationships. It's keeping you from having redeemed relationships. Let me put it this way. If you have any of these fears, and as we talk about this, just allow God to expose your heart here and do a little checkup on your heart. If you have any of these fears, then you may be real. You may be an authentic person. You just may be contaminating people in the process. You may be raw. And so let me give you the three fundamental fears that are keeping us from good relationships. Here they are. Number one is human weakness. Hidden weaknesses. Each of us, we fear like public exposure. We fear, you know, getting it out, like the secrets. We feel fear like people knowing what really is going on in my life or in my marriage, or if people really knew who I was, then they sure wouldn't like me. Who could like me if they really knew what I've done? They really knew how my marriage is. And so there's these hidden weaknesses, and you see it all the time. You see it all the time in public figures a lot. Politicians trying to hide their mess ups. Isn't that for the American people? We despise the hiding of it more than the sin itself. It's like why don't you just admit it? Or athletes, you know, these public figures, these athletes that cheat and they fraud and they try to get by, and it's like it's you know what though? It's easy to judge these people in public offices and public figures, but we've all worn that mask. We've all hidden parts of our lives, and we've all tried to hidden some of our weaknesses and opportunities that we really don't want people to see and know because of fear. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2 says, we refuse to wear masks and play games. And that's what I'm challenging you today. Just refuse. We refuse here at Discovery. We ain't going to do it. We refuse to wear the mask and play the game. We're not going to do it. Rather, we keep everything we do and say out in the open, the whole truth on display so that those who want to can see. And again, it's either raw or redeemed, what's out in the open. It's either raw or redeemed. And if you really want to be free, learn from Jesus. Don't hide. Be real. Step into the light of Christ. And you see, that light isn't there. The light of Christ is not there to condemn you. It's not there to put a spotlight on you and go, check it. Look at you, sinner. Look at how bad and disgusting or evil or that's not what the light is there for. That light is there to reconcile you. That's what that light is there to bring it onto the open so that you can be made whole. Look at this. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. You see, if I'm not in darkness, if I'm not hiding those things, man, we can have fellowship. We can walk together. Without that, though, we can't. If I'm hiding things, there's no true fellowship. If we claim to be without sin, if we act like it's not there and I'm just going to pretend and leave the mask on, then we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. Hidden weaknesses. That's a fear that's going to keep you from having healthy, authentic, redeemed relationships. Here's the second thing, the fundamental fear that's going to keep you from good relationships, and that is the desire for approval. The desire for approval. This is where I just need to be liked. I need to be approved. The fear of rejection is birthed out of this. Like I'm afraid of just being, you know, being rejected or being rebuffed or it's like those TV shows, like the Survivor and The Weakest Link and all those things where they get voted off. I can't stand those shows. It's hard for me to watch those shows because I hate rejection. I hate seeing other people get rejected. I feel so bad for them. I really do. But how many of you remember in grade school, you ever played Truth or Dare? Remember played Truth or Dare? And we always, how many of you like me, you always did the dare? You always did it, didn't you? Why? Because you wanted to be liked. We wanted to be liked. We want to be approved. We want to be loved. How many of you know that, there's a need inside of you. Every one of us have the need to be loved. God created you that way. But so many people were raised with this conditional love, maybe in their homes, or from the people around them, where you only get love if you continue to please me. And so we try to live for the approval of others and we fear the rejection, because when that stops, when I cannot live to their standard, I don't get the love that I desire anymore. That desire for approval will keep you from having authentic relationships. Studies show that your self-esteem is related to the way you see yourself. And the studies show that the way you see yourself, your self-esteem, is a large portion. It's directly connected to the closest person to you, like in your life, how they think about you and what they say about you. That's where most of your self-esteem comes from. Is where the closest person, the person you spend the most time with, the person that you love the most, that's there the most, how they think about you and what they say about you, in a large part determines your self-esteem. Proverbs 29 and 25 says that the fear of man will prove to be a snare. Like if I continue to be afraid of their rejection or the need for their approval, you're going to continue to get tripped up. Your relationships will continue to be sabotaged as long as you have that fear of man. It's going to snare you. But whoever trusts in the Lord is kept safe. We're talking about being authentic, and there are some things that prevent us from doing that. Hidden weaknesses, desire for approval. Here's the last one, and that is past hurts. Past hurts. That's where some of us fear being hurt again. We fear being taken advantage of again. We fear being walked out on again. We fear being lied to again. We fear being manipulated again. We fear being humiliated again. We have these same hurts and we're afraid. So we build up these walls around us to not let anyone get in again. I'm so glad American Idol is off the air. I mean, I could not stand. I'm serious. I can't stand watching these shows where they humiliate people and they make it just where they're so rejected. And because you can see it, the voice is better anyway. I'm so glad the voice stayed. And American Idol is gone. But you can see it that they, some of them, it's funny to see the different reactions, right? Some of them just, they handle it well. And then others are just crying, broken down, just like, you can tell, I can tell looking, I'm like, oh my God, they just, a seed of negativity and doubt was just deposited in their life. And like a dog that's been beaten, they kind of whimper and tuck their tail between their leg and kind of get off that stage. It's sad what past hurts can do to you. So what do we do? What do we do? I'm telling you, the solution is definitely don't conceal it. Don't hide it away. Don't act like it's not there. Here's the solution, James chapter 5, verse 16. Therefore, confess your sins to who? To each other. Yeah, I mean, we can confess them to God. We're supposed to confess them to God. But here's one of the secrets that moving from this state of just being raw, unfiltered, contaminated, in order to move to a redeemed state and authentically redeemed, I'm telling you, cannot do it without authentic relationships. You can't. It's impossible. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you can finally get over that hurt. So that you can finally get the healing you've been desired over that pain. So that you can finally be free from that stronghold, from that bondage. Confess your sins to each other so that you may be healed. Let me ask you this. How's it working for you the way you're doing it? How's that working as you continue to hide it and tuck it away? I mean, if you're honest, you'd say today, it's not working. I'm still hurt. It's still affecting my relationships. Pastor, I can see how I'm contaminating people. I can see, I look back at my past and my relationships and how I never really dealt with that stuff, and it's manifesting in my kids. It's manifesting in this at work. It's because it's not working, Pastor. No, it's not. What do we do? Let's study how Jesus did it. Let's do what Jesus did. Be transparent. Be human enough to admit your need. And I'll take it a step further even, and I think that the church is the place where you do that in. That is, that in order to move from this state of being raw to the state of being redeemed, you're still real, it's just a different state. The way you do that is through authentic relationships with the local church. I'm telling you, that's God's plan. I know the church is maybe not a popular thing for a lot of people, but it is God's plan. It's what Jesus came here to establish. Do you know that? When Jesus told Peter, hey, upon your confession that I'm the Christ, upon that confession, I will build my church, he said, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That's God's plan, to push back the enemy lines, to push back the gates of, to take the territory from the devil is the local, it's the church. So I want to challenge you today to not only be transparent, but I'm going to show you how the church actually plays that role in your authenticity and in your transparency. And it's really sad, man, that some people, they can't do it with, or they find it hard to do it in this context and in the spiritual context. I got a call years ago in ministry from a lady, the receptionist took it, gave it to me, and she was wanting counsel. She said, Pastor, are you a pastor at first? Yeah, I'm a pastor here. And okay, I really need some help. I'm about to leave. I'm about to leave my husband. My bags are packed, but you know what? I'm just giving it one last shot. Like, we really desperately need help. And she began to explain some of the things that were going on. I said, okay. How long have you been coming to Discovery? Are you a part of Discovery? And oh, no. I go to another church. I said, why? What do you mean you go? You're and she told me the church. I said, really? She said, yeah, I'm a leader there. I do this ministry at this church. And I said, I was so confused. I said, wait a second. How come you're not talking to Pastor so-and-so? I mean, how come you're not going to your pastor? And she, I'm telling you, I will never forget this guy. She said, oh, no. They can never know that I'm dealing with this. They can never know about my marriage, like that this is happening. Because if they did, then I wouldn't be able to. And it was such a sad moment for me talking to this lady on the phone that was so hidden from the people that she's supposed to be transparent with, that she was living a fake, phony life. It's so sad. And I'm telling you, you will never reach your potential. You will never reach your potential until you can get to this place of admitting your need. Be human enough to admit your need. There are four reasons why you need to be transparent. And there's four metaphors that descriptions of the church that Jesus uses to describe the church. It gives us a clear picture. It helps us to know what the church should be like. Let me give you four reasons why you should, you know, study how Jesus did it and just be transparent and admit your need here today. But I'm going to show you how it connects to the church. Here it is. You need to be transparent. Number one, write this down. We need to be transparent because we need support. We need support. I don't care how strong you are or how tough you think you are or how spiritual you think you are. Every single one of us in this room, myself included, needs support. We need something in our life solid. We need something in our life that we can trust, that we can reach out to, that we can rely on, because we all go through trouble. I remember years ago when we first started Discovery, we had a Monday night football group, and we do it every season when football season starts up again, NFL season starts up again. We had this Monday night football group, and I knew we were going to attract the people who didn't want to go to a group. You know what I'm saying? The guys who were like, I'm not going to no group, but I'll go to that one. You know, I'll go watch football. And so I was like, yeah, let's do this group. So that's what happened. We got the couples and the husbands that really didn't want to be a part of any community but wanted to watch football. So we tricked them. You know what I'm saying? So it was halftime. We TiVo'd it, so we paused it, and we just had a little bit of, and some of our group was right here, part of our first Monday night football group. We paused it, and we just had a little devotion. We went around the room, just shared any prayer requests, and went back to the game. Always had a good meal. It was fantastic. It was so awesome. I'm telling you guys, about 4 weeks, 5 weeks into this group, that these hard men that built up, you know, walls around themselves started to let some people in and say, you know what, I'm in need. You know what, I need some people to talk to. You know what, I need support. I'm not as strong as maybe it looks. I got this issue going on with my ex. I have this going on at work, and I need you guys to pray, please. I need some support. It was a beautiful thing. I'm telling you, you need support. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 21, 22 says, in him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, check this out, you two, that's us, are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Let me tell you something, that you alone, you aren't the full, the complete temple of God. You aren't. Now, you are a temple. You host the presence of God and the Holy Spirit. So, yes, your body is a temple because of that, but you are not a complete temple. You need the Bible says that we together, when we come together as the church, that we are the temple where the host, where God's presence dwells. Look at it. Here's the metaphor. The church is a building. The church is a building. Now, don't get me wrong. Some of you are like, no, it's not. No, I know. It's not this. I'm talking about the metaphor. This is not the church that we're standing in. This thing, these walls, this concrete. No, this is, when we leave, they're probably going to put doctor's offices here, okay? There ain't nothing. This is not the church. This isn't the building that Jesus is talking about. You are. I am. And you don't stand alone. You are a pillar. You are a post. You are a part. But you are not the complete temple. It is when we gather together as the building, the temple of God, that his presence is magnified in our life. You need support. You need some more pillars, some more posts, some more buildings. You need it. I'm telling you, you need to be transparent because we need support, no matter how strong you think you are. And I'm telling you, here at Discovery, what's key for this is small groups, our Discovery groups. I'm telling you, you're going to come to a point where you need support. You're going to come to a point where you're having a terrible day, a painful season, a difficult circumstance. It's going to happen. It's called life. And Jesus is not above it either. He's hanging on the cross. And here he is admitting his need. I'm thirsty. You're going to come to a point of your life in a season or a day where you're going to need some people around you that you say, hey, I need help. I'm thirsty. I'm hurting. I'm in need. I need support. The church is a building. Here's the second reason why we need to be transparent. You guys write it down. And that is because I need to grow. I need to be transparent because I need to grow. Here's a common fallacy. A lot of people think that you can grow in isolation. You can't grow spiritually in isolation. God can do a lot of things in that prayer closet, in your own study time, in your own devotion time. Absolutely, he can do some things, but truly spiritual growth always happens in the context of fellowship. It is when we take what God is telling us in the secret place, is telling us in our devotion place, and we apply it to life in our relationships. That's where growth happens. You don't grow spiritually in isolation. You grow spiritually in fellowship. We need growth. That's why the metaphor the Bible uses for the church is a body. A body. Now, it might be a gross illustration. Pardon me for the gross illustration. But if you took a child, you know, and you cut his hand off. I know, I'm sorry. But this, you're going to get the point. You cut the child's hand off, okay? That child will continue to grow. But that hand stops. It's been disconnected from the body. It is disconnected from the source. It's disconnected from the life of that which allows it to be built up. If it's left alone, it's going to die. It eventually will just decay. Look what Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16 tells us about this metaphor. It says, from him, that's Christ, from Christ, the whole body, that's us, were joined and held together by each other. By our supporting ligaments, man. When we attach our lives together, by the supporting ligaments, it grows and builds itself up in love. How do we do that? How does that happen? As each part does its work. See, there's a function for every person in the body of Christ. There's a part. There's a gift. There's an ability. There's a destiny. There's a purpose that God has for every person that is a part of the body of Christ. And that's where at Discovery we have the dream team. That's what we call it. It's the people who are actively living out the gifts, the destiny, and the purpose that God has for their life. And when we do that, when we are doing our part, I'm telling you, we grow up spiritually. You don't grow on the sideline. You don't grow as a spectator. You don't grow in the pew. You don't grow from watching that online thing that you're committed to. You don't grow. No. You grow when you do your part, when you step out. I'm telling you, you don't grow in isolation. You grow when you step out. Colossians 2:19 says, we are joined together in his body by his strong sinews, and we grow as we get our nourishment and strength from God. The church is a body. We need to be transparent because we need to grow. Here's the third reason why we need to be transparent. Taking Jesus' principle, he's sharing with us here. Man, some of you are in a bad season right now, in a difficult season. If not, it's coming, okay? Someone said you're either coming out of, in, or about to go into a storm. Okay, so is that going to happen? You're in one of these stages, and you need to know this. You need to apply these principles. This needs to be the framework that you process your difficult season. Here's number three, why we need to be transparent. And that is because I need protection. I need protection. There is strength in numbers. Ecclesiastes tells this story that man, if one traveling by himself, he says, they could be overtaken, they could be attacked and overtaken, but if two or a number are traveling, they can defend themselves. Some of you have secrets. You still have hidden things. You have hidden things that no one else knows, and I'm telling you, you're not safe with your secrets. As long as that's in the dark, you know that's the devil's playground, is in the dark. That's what as long as that stays in the dark, the enemy has control. It's only when you bring it into the light do you take the control and the authority away from him. I'm telling you, some of you have secrets and you're not safe. You're not safe with your own secrets. Someone else needs to know. You need to share your secrets with some people. You need to share those secrets. This is why Jesus, his favorite metaphor for the church is a flock, like sheep. We need protection, you guys. And just like a shepherd protects his flock, Jesus, the chief shepherd of the church, is the covering for the body of Christ. Not only that, that you need, I'm telling you, I believe every person needs a pastor. Every person needs pastors who are shepherding, caring for, watching over, praying for you. Every person does. This is the encouragement that Peter gives us, 1 Peter 5 and 2. He's telling the overseers and the leaders of the church, he says, be shepherds. That word there is pastors. Be pastors, be shepherds of God's flock that are under your care. I'm telling you, you need protection, and the body of Christ is what gives you that spiritual protection. Everybody needs a church. I believe that. If you don't have a church, not only are you not going to be able to make this transition from raw to real, but you're never going to reach your potential. You're never going to get the protection you need in life. I'm telling you, this is more than a service. We do more than just gather on Sundays and celebrate. This is more than a celebration. This, you guys, is a family. It's the church. And no church is, some people tell me sometimes, they're like, well, man, Pastor, I miss when we were small enough that I knew everybody. I miss that time when I could go to the same service and we knew everybody. Now, and then some people are like, oh, I miss when we had two services and now we're at three services. People are like, man, I don't see anybody. It's like, and we're about to go to four services and you know, someday, real soon, in Jesus' name. And people, you know what? It's too big. A too big church is more about attitude than it is about size. Because 200 people is too big. That's too big. You can't really know and walk in community with 200 people. You can't do that. I mean, it's more of about an attitude. And if you get connected to the church, if you can get connected to a group, get connected somewhere where you are serving and doing your part, I'm telling you, you will develop lifelong friendships. And you talk to someone who's connected at Discovery. You talk to them, they'll tell you they have developed some lifelong friendships here. Because we're the body of Christ. I lead a Wednesday night small group, a couple small group with my wife, and we have a whole bunch of different group leaders that are with us, and we have they're at different round tables, and they kind of, we have about like six small groups that meet together in one place, and it is so beautiful. I love seeing people get connected and the protection that they even receive from being connected. There's this guy named Louie and Delia. I'm not sure if they're in this service or not, but a lot of you know Louie, and there they are. Man, I was so happy to see them connecting to the body of Christ. But it was Louis's birthday a while back, and he stepped into our small group, and I was surprised to see him on his birthday. I'm like, what's Louis doing here on his birthday? And he told someone, there's nowhere else I'd rather be but with my friends on my birthday. Now, a lot of you may not know, but we're praying for Louis. Louis has cancer, and we're believing in Jesus' name that he is going to be healed and completely free of that in Jesus' name. And it's so beautiful that for me to even see and to look that these group leaders and that group itself are just loving this family and loving each other. And they're caring. Like, it's just not my job. It's not just the pastor's job to do all the pastoring. It's not. We share pastoring here, that we're to carry one another's burdens. Like John 15 says, it's actually Jesus' plan. Jesus says, my command is this for all of us. Love each other as I have loved you. Come on, love each other. This is what that love looks like. He says, greater love is no one than this, than that he lay down his life for his friends. I'm telling you, you need some friends like that. They're going to put a prayer shield around you. You need some friends that can develop a prayer shield around you, a protection. Be transparent, because you need support, because you need to grow, because you need protection. Here's the fourth reason to be transparent I want to give you today, and that is because we need to be loved. And that's okay to admit that. I mean, that's okay. We need to be transparent because we need to be loved. And you can't get that love if you're going to be guarded, if you're going to put up the walls all the time, if you're not going to let anybody in to see the real you, the authentic you, with all the issues, with all the hurts, with all the past, with just you. And I'm telling you, every one of us have them. I have them. I have issues. I have things that constantly that God will remind me of, or things that get out of alignment, and God says, Jason, stop it. Let's say, forgive me, God. Every one of us, look, and if you're here today and you're shocked that a pastor's saying that, and you think you got it all together, you probably won't fit in here at Discovery Church, okay? You just won't. But look, if you still have some issues, if you still have some things that you got to work out, if you still have some habits, if you kind of have a few screws loose, this could be your church. This is a church for those who are broken, who know they've blown it, and who want to change, who want to grow, who want to make a difference. Here's the fourth metaphor for the church. We need to be loved. And the church is a family where you get that love. Unconditional love. Ephesians 2:19 says that you are a member of God's very own family. You know, this family that you're a part of, that we're a part of, everybody look here. This family is even stronger and thicker than the blood that you were born into. The spiritual family. What holds us together is not the blood of any, is not the blood of parents. It's the blood of Christ. And that blood goes from this life to the next life. You and I, us, will always be family. We'll always have each other. Look, and if you want to move to this place of raw, of having unfiltered emotion and your past hurts and your mistakes and your issues to a place where you are redeemed and authentic and real, then you need to do it in this context with the body of Christ, with the family of Christ. And until you do, you'll never reach your potential. You'll never truly be protected. You'll never grow to your potential. You won't get the support you need in the time you need it and the day you need it most. Be human enough to admit we need each other. Come on, let's bow our heads right there. Just